So let's start. Okay, so my name is Weidong from Huawei. So, and yeah, today I will introduce our new increase more resource so then it can provide more capabilities. So, we care about is two dimensions of scalability on a single server because virtualization is running on a single server. So here is one dimension is we want to support more VMs and more users when hardware resource is increased. And the other one is we also want to support a larger VM. Okay, so here is some brief introduce of current Xen status about related to the scalability. So currently Xen 4.7, yeah, the max limits is for host it can support up to more than 4,000 physical CPUs and 16 TB memories, right? And for the VM, it can support up to 512 vCPUs and 1 TB virtual memories. And also, yeah, 3 years ago, yeah, Wei, they introduced the Xen hypervisor can scale to support thousands of VMs. So they experimented 3,000 VMs. Okay, so here is we listed some scalability patches in upstream. So like in a full ground table, yeah. So mainly it's use finer grain locks to improve the scalability. Like we split larger lock to more lockers and use like a read-write lock, something like that. Also, it implemented the persistent grants to avoid the grant operation and the tier B flash cost. So it also can improve the virtual block scalability. And the other one is for the event channel. Yeah, it's can extend it to support more event channels. So it can be support more VMs, more CPU vCPUs like that. And also, it can we use poor event channel lock for sending events. On scheduler, we found that it's the node affinity for vCPU load balance. It's very useful for NUMA architecture systems. And also, there are some improvement on P2M. Okay, so the next year we will introduce some of our findings and also we will present some proposals. Nowadays more and more cores are integrated to a CPU. So we found there are more than hundreds of CPU cores on a big server like 8P servers. So it requires the hypervisor to better support many core scalabilities. Okay, so next we will introduce some of our findings. Okay, so the first bottleneck we found is it's the ticket spin lock. Ticket spin lock is the default spin lock in Xen hypervisor. So it's very, ticket spin lock is it's for fair, right? For fair scheduling. So it's perform very good for small servers, but it's not scalable for many core or bigger server big service. Because the ticket spin lock, it's spin on a global variable, and when unlock operation, it will invalidate the variables. So it will lots of overhead there in many code case. So the proposal is use the scalable lock. So like MCS lock is scalable for many cores because it's spin on a local variable. So it can generate a constant number of cache missing per acquisition and then can avoid performance collapse with many cores. Okay, so the next bottleneck is we found is about core lock. Yeah, so the core lock is a global lock and it's used in function unselected CPUs. So it's used to protect IPIs. We found if there are lots of PCPUs, so it will become a block because it will there will be heavy contention. So one example is we found there are frequent EPT entries change, so which will invalidate EPT EPTs related to, on the PCPUs. So it will so. Next, we will have a test case to show that. Okay, so the proposal is first we suggest to replace the ticket spin lock with MCS lock for core lock. And then we also to make the core lock from global to per CPU lock. So here is, we can see here, because if the core lock is global, so you when you to send IPIs to the target, maybe like CPU1, so you will block all the CPU's IPI. So it when the server has hundreds of CPUs, so it will be the cost is will be big. Change to the post CPU log. So if you send IPI to the CPU1, so it's just the block, get the log from the PCP1. So other CPUs still can available for IPIs. Okay, so here is we did some test on that. So we are using 8 sockets server. It's the CPU thread is 192. And we using Zen 4.7. So the test case is we want to build frequent IPIs. That so here is we are using Windows virtual machine and also each VM has 64 vCPUs. Yeah, so we will launch 8 VC Windows VMs with POD enabled in parallel. Then during the Windows guest booting, so it will zero pages. So that operation will allocate the memories. Then it also will change the EPT entries. So there will result lots of APIs to do the EPT sync. And then after that, we also configured the memory reserve to 70%, like. So after the after it allocated memories more than beyond that thread, then it will be start to scan the yellow pages and the recycle pages. So it also will go to frequently change the EPT entries. Okay, so that's the our test case. So here we can see the results. So the first one is about the lock weight. So here we can see with our optimization, so the number of lock weight is very low. And yeah, so the lock weight is means when it to get the lock, but it cannot be get the lock immediately, so it needed to lock, right? To wait. So that's calculated that number of the lock weight. So we can see, with our optimization, yeah, we can see it's improved a lot. So here you can see at that point, yeah, all the VMs is down booting, so it's will be down over the waiting numbers. So the another thing is we also measure the consumption of each lock weight. So here we also can see with our optimization, it's also can reduce the significantly of that. Okay. So next bottleneck we are found is about the vCPU load balance in credit in scheduler. So the vCPU load balance means it's when the next highest run queue vCPU, it find it's already eating its credits, so it will to look at other CPUs to see there are more urgent tasks. So the process is like here is the first it will select non-idling CPUs, then go then get the acquire the schedule lock of the non-scheduling CPU, then it go to try to steer tasks from that CPUs. But if you find it cannot steer the tasks, so it will skip to the next PCPUs. So
the reason it can't steal a task is because there's only one task running, is that right?
Sorry, one task?
Why would it not be able to steal a task? Is it because there's only one task running?
No.
On that CPU?
One task running, no. So the load balance is means, the CPU load is not balanced. So some CPU is maybe it's idle or some
sure.
Yeah, the task is okay.
Yeah, but you said I'm a CPU, I want to steal some work.
Yeah.
I grab the lock and then I find I can't steal work. Why can't I steal any work? Is it because there's no extra work to steal? Is that right?
It has some judges to see if it find that task is the priority is higher than yeah. Yeah, so here we can so the bottleneck of this is if because there is lots of in case there like in hundreds of cores, so it will be tried one by one. But in some case, if like vCPU is pinged on some PCPUs, so that in that case, actually you cannot stick task from that PCPUs. So, but it still will to try. So it will waste lots of so it's a bigger waste in that case. Our proposal is we want to add a check before trying to the acquiring the lock and try to do the steer. So here is the idea is we add a bitmap for each PCPUs. that bitmap will record the its vCPUs, wrong queue vCPUs, which PCPUs that vCPUs can run. Yeah, so, and then start the load balance, so it will, first it will go to check that bitmap. So can I get that? Yeah, still tasks. So if the bitmap, the PCPU is not in that bitmap, that means you cannot steal. So it don't need to get locked, it's just return. So it can, in the like vCPU ping case, it will be reduced lots of lock acquirings. Okay. Actually, by default, in some high performance case, yeah, we will ping the vCPUs to 1-1 ping vCPUs. But usually, we are actually we also will ping the vCPUs to a range of the PCPU, like in a node PCPU. So yeah, so this is a normal case. No. Okay, so the yeah, so the hardware and the software is the similar. So we are evaluated the 1-1 ping case. So yeah, because that's where be optimized significant case. So the results is for this, we can see also we measure the number of the weight. Here with the optimization, yeah, we can see the number is reduced dramatically. And also the consuming is also, over each lock is also can be done. Okay, so here's the summary. So we found, because there are currently, we found more customers, they are start to use some bigger servers, like four socket or eight socket servers. So we found, and in some case, that scalability is not performance good. Yeah, so, and we also found some scenarios, as I introduced now. So we found there are still some bottlenecks in Xen Hypervisor about the manifold scalabilities. And also in future work, we are thinking, currently we don't find there are good virtualization scalability benchmarks we can use to measure the hypervisor scalabilities. So currently we are just mainly we are using scenarios one by one to do some try, and we will find some typical or some special scenarios to do that, so to figure out some bottlenecks. So we hope in future can figure out can cover more scenarios, and also can select some typical scenarios can measure the hypervisor scalability. And also the measurement is also currently we are just use for log or for some micro benchmarks we are wrong. So it's to see it's perform good or not. And also in future, we also want to do maybe we hope it can be have a benchmark to measure the scalability will be have linear scale or not or something like that. So it will be very helpful for us to show customers what's the scalability capabilities for that. Okay, so the another one is we also want to support more larger VMs. So that is useful for some critical machine critical tasks, like a memory database case or something like that. So currently, then, like in the for that on the max limit, we can see the memory is only can support one TB. But and also we found that supported the 1TB, it cannot be migrated. Yeah, so there are some limitations on that. So the feature work we are just thinking about. Okay, so that's all. Currently we have a prototype, so I think we can send out later.
If you make your prototype and you write RFC, then it's okay to have incomplete patches. You can send them early.
Mm. Yeah, so currently the MCS lock is currently is another issue is it will change the API is not similar to the ticket spin lock. So currently we are just used for the code spin lock to measure it can help or not.
Are you using it straight from the MCS paper, or are you actually using Linux Qtick?
So maybe the Q log, the API is the same to the ticket spin lock, maybe better. So currently, we are just use MCS spin lock and tried for the core lock case. Okay. Yeah, but we can see it. It has some improved for spin lock. That is just one test case. We want to show that. Yeah.
What are the situations that you encounter this where you had a lot of DBT changes?
The POD why not resulted the EPT changes?
Anytime you need to send an IPI to a mask. Right? Mm.
You mean for huge VM case?
Yeah.
In that case, it depends on some cases maybe like a small number, maybe like one or two. Yeah, in such a case, because they require the high performance, so yeah. The CPU is not to be overcommitted, right?
But
so
it will be.
It also need a ping. Yes.
Did you look into it and reject it, or did you not think too much about it?
No, actually we didn't look at deeply.
One of the reasons CPU pools were invented was because pinning screws up the algorithms of the scheduler.
Okay.
So it's not at all surprising that when you do a lot of pinning, the scheduler doesn't behave well. So one thing is to try and fix each individual case as it comes up. But another option is to just use the pools to partition things up rather than using pinning.
Or you use
a combination. Like if you have a pool with one VM in it and then you pin that VM, there should be no problem.
Okay.
That's true, yeah. So another thing that we were talking about is having having a null scheduler.
Right.
So you make a CPU pool, one dimension, and it puts things there and doesn't do anything.
So any questions? All right. Thank you.